this is a special service this morning, water baptism, and we'll be baptizing 5 candidates in water in just a little while. Praise the Lord. And so God is good. God is good. And you're going to hear some amazing testimonies this morning about what God has been doing in hearts and lives, and they are going to bless your heart this morning. Praise God. But now I want you to turn in your Bibles, if you would, to the book of Romans. Book of Romans this morning, Romans chapter 6, Romans the 6th chapter this morning, be looking at verses 4 and 5. I want to minister this morning on water baptism. I've entitled the message, Water Baptism. Is it just dead tradition and form and ritual, or is it living water baptism? Is it just dead tradition? Is it just another form? Is it just another ritual that we go through in the world of religion? Or is it living truth for today? Praise God. Water baptism this morning. Would you stand with me when you find Romans chapter 6 this morning? Look with me at verses 4 and 5. Reading from the New International Version this morning. Verse 4 says, we were therefore buried with him through baptism into faith, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. If we have been united with him like this in his death, we will certainly also be united with him in his resurrection. Somebody say amen to that this morning. In baptism, we are united with him in his death, but also united with him in resurrection power. Praise God. Hallelujah. Baptism symbolizes death to the old life, death to the old self, death to the way we used to act, death to the way we used to talk. Come on, somebody say amen, somebody. How many knows a lot of us talk differently than we did before we were saved? We talk differently now. We're a new creation in Jesus. How many knows the Bible says, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature or a new creation. All things have passed away. All things have become new. Praise God. And water baptism symbolizes newness of life. Praise God. Hallelujah. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word this morning. And Lord, I ask that, Lord, you would anoint your servant, you would anoint God, the word of God, your word this morning as it goes forth. And Lord, I pray that God, you would anoint the ear and the hearts of every listener today. Help us, Lord, to receive your word. And I pray that, Lord, if there are those here that have never fully understood the significance, the importance, the essential value of water baptism and have not taken that step, that Lord, this morning you would bring conviction upon their hearts and their minds today, and they'll recognize, Lord, that this is not something that we can take or leave it, but Lord, it is an essential command of you, Lord. You have commanded us to be baptized in water in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Lord, give us ears to hear this morning what the Spirit would say to the church. And Lord, we'll thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. You may be seated this morning. Praise God. Story is told of a baptismal service where, after coming up out of the water, having just been baptized, one member of the church said, my goodness, Pastor, I can't believe it. I forgot to remove my wallet from my pants. Now my wallet's dripping wet, soaking wet. I know you told me to take my wallet out and I forgot, and now my wallet's soaked. And the preacher looked at him and he wasn't concerned that much at all. He said, well, praise God, hallelujah. We could stand some more baptized wallets, amen? Sounds like something a preacher would say, doesn't it? Amen. But it's my desire this morning in this message, and in this service, to try to just provide some maybe some fresh new insight, or maybe just some fresh reminders of things that you've heard before. You've been taught in Sunday school, or you've heard preached from the pulpit, some insight and full understanding and clarity on this subject, the subject of water baptism. So as to make this ordinance of the church, this sacrament, if you will, a meaningful, enriching experience for those that may be a candidate for baptism that are being baptized this morning, or for those that in the near future should be baptized and have not yet been baptized. And this message is even for those who have already been baptized in water, but maybe really didn't fully understand what they were doing or how important and how significant it was to be baptized in water. So this morning I want us to have a new appreciation for the ordinance of the church called water baptism. There are only two ordinances of the church. One is Holy Communion, when we come to the table of the Lord and we take the symbols of the blood and of the broken body of Jesus, and we remember His sacrificial death at Calvary. And the other is water baptism, the two ordinances of the church. And I think for us to have a full understanding and a deep appreciation this morning, first of all, we have to have a good definition of water baptism to really understand what water baptism truly is, what that word means, what the act of baptism signifies in the life of a believer, in the life of the church. And I think to get a good working definition this morning of water baptism, there are three important words that we need to use to understand this morning what this thing called water baptism really is all about today. First of all, baptism is a symbol. That's an important word in understanding water baptism. Baptism is a symbol, and a symbol is just simply something that you can see, that you can tangibly hold or tangibly look at, that your naked eye, your natural eye can see, that represents a truth or an idea that you cannot see with your natural eye. For instance, the olive branch has become the universal international symbol of peace, hasn't it? How many would say amen to that? Whenever we see a picture of an olive branch, or we think of an olive branch, we think of an olive branch being extended by the leader of one nation to another nation that says, I want to have peace between us, peace between you and I, peace between our nations. So that olive branch is a symbol. It's a tangible thing that we can see, that we can touch, that we can hold, and it symbolizes something else. The wedding ring is a symbol of marriage, isn't it? And in the same way, water baptism this morning is a symbol of our identification with Jesus Christ in His death, in His burial, and in His resurrection. Would you say amen this morning? Praise God. What a wonderful thing to do, to identify with Jesus Christ and what He did at Calvary, and the fact that on the third day He came forth from the tomb victorious over death, hell, and the grave. Hallelujah. When we come up out of that water, it symbolizes that because Jesus Christ died for our sins, we can be set free from our sins, cleansed from our sin. And when we come up out of that water, it indicates that just as Christ is alive today and has everlasting life, you and I have everlasting life in Jesus. That ought to make somebody a little bit happy here this morning. Praise God. I love to identify with my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. There's nobody else in this world that I want to identify with like I want to identify with Jesus. He's my everything. Yeah. Secondly, there's that word right. Not R-I-G-H-T as though that is my right, but R-I-T-E. We often use that word as a rite of passage. We use it in that context, but baptism is a rite. And a rite is simply a symbol, which we've already described, that you use regularly, not just once in a while, but regularly for a sacred, holy purpose, for a spiritual purpose. Water baptism today, friends, is a rite because it's a symbol that the church of the living God uses on a regular basis. When people get saved, we're to baptize them in water. Somebody say amen. It's something we ought to do often. In fact, my prayer is, God, I pray that you would save enough people in this church every Sunday morning, every Sunday night, even on Wednesday nights, that we have to leave the baptistry up all the time and we never have to take it down. All we have to do is change the water once in a while. Amen? There are a lot of churches that baptize every Sunday. I trust that you'll make that prayer as well, and that petition to God with me, and join with me in that. God, let us baptize new converts every single week. Praise God. Water baptism, thirdly, is an ordinance. And an ordinance is simply a sacred symbol that teaches important truths, important doctrines of the Christian faith that is intended to be exercised in an ongoing way everywhere throughout the world. Water baptism is something that is to be done by the church universal, not just a few churches, not just some churches, but every Bible-believing, Bible-teaching, truth-preaching church ought to be baptizing people in water. Would you say amen? That's an ordinance. It's a symbol of a truth, a doctrine that we need to exercise everywhere and in an ongoing way everywhere in the world. Communion and water baptism are sacraments, or they are ordinances, in the fact that they're nothing less than sacred vows of allegiance to Jesus Christ. How many have made your allegiance and pledged your allegiance to Jesus Christ? I believe in pledging allegiance to the flag, don't you? I love my country. I'm a patriotic person. It's a privilege to put my hand over my heart and to pledge allegiance to the United States of America. I love this land. I love this country. But even more important to me is pledging allegiance to the Lamb of God. Hallelujah. To the Lamb of God, the Savior of my soul. Yes, when I pledge allegiance to the flag, I'm indicating I'm pledging allegiance to a land of liberty, the land of the free, the home of the brave. But when I pledge allegiance to the Lamb of God, to my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, I'm pledging allegiance to the one who paid the ultimate price and gave everything he had so that I can be liberated from sin. Hallelujah! I'm no longer a sin-sick soul, but I am a soul saved by grace. Liberated from the law of sin and death. No longer held in bondage to sin. Aren't you glad you've been liberated from sin this morning? Hallelujah. If you go back to the first century, Roman soldiers, every single one of them, down to a man, had to take an oath to obey their commander, their military commander, whoever was over them. And they had to take an oath to obey him, whatever he asked them to do. They had to obey even unto death. If it meant they had to die to be obedient to their commander, they would die. They had an oath to obey unto death. And with that oath, that pledge, it was called a sacramentum. And of course, that's where we get the word today, sacrament. That oath, that pledge of the Roman soldiers was the sacramentum. And so today, water baptism is a sacrament. Today in the 21st century, it is an oath. It is an oath we make to Jesus Christ. It is a pledge of allegiance to obedience to God. Baptism shows, friends, in a public way, in front of all your brothers and sisters in the Lord, in front of your friends, in front of your family, that we have a brand new nature. We have a change of heart. Praise God. We are pledging allegiance to somebody else now. Praise God. We're no longer in allegiance to the enemy of our soul, but we are in allegiance to the deliverer of our soul. Would you say amen this morning? Praise God. It says when you go into the waters of baptism and you go into that baptistry, you're saying, I pledge allegiance to Jesus Christ because he's given me a new nature, a new character, a new talk, a new walk, And he's given me a brand new heart. Would somebody say amen? It shows that what is now most important to us of anything in this world is doing the will of God. More important than anything else, I am pledging allegiance to the will of God. More important than doing anybody else's will, if pleasing anybody else is pleasing my Lord and Savior. My baptism, it goes back 40 years now to when I was baptized. If I could have a little more monitor this morning, please, I appreciate that. But my baptism 40 years ago when I was 12 years of age, it was a pledge. It was an oath that I made to God that I will do all that I can, praise God, for Jesus Christ, because he's the one that has done everything for me. Amen. That's how it was explained to me. When you're baptized, you're saying, I declare that my life is in the hands of the Lord Jesus Christ. And where he says to go, I will go. What he tells me to say, I will say. What he tells me to do, I will do. I am doing the will of God. It was a pledge. It was an oath. I'll do all I can for the one who's done everything for me. And I look back on my water baptism experience in the same way that I look back on my wedding day. In both cases, I made a confession and a profession voluntarily. There was not an arranged marriage between Lisa and I. I got to choose my wife. She got to choose her husband. I choose well. I'm not so sure about her. But we chose each other for better or for worse. Right? Voluntarily, we made vows. We pledged our love for each other for the rest of our lives. And that means something to me that I said, till death do us part. That means something. And we did it in front of witnesses. It was witness, the oath, the pledge that we took. I realized that I made vows in both cases. Promises to God in my baptism, promises to my wife in my marriage. And I can't violate either one of those contracts as long as I live. It's that important. You see, baptism, it tells the entire world that God loves and God receives the worst of sinners through Jesus Christ. And that the God of this universe, he is a God of grace. He is a gracious God. He's a merciful God. In the same way, God speaks to the human race with every single rainbow that he paints in the sky. I don't know about you, I think one of the most beautiful things in nature is the rainbow. I love to see a rainbow. I love it when the sun comes out when it's raining and you can look up. How many have seen some of the beautiful rainbows we've had in our area recently? We've seen some that go from one end to the other. You can see the whole rainbow. We've had some beautiful double rainbows that you can see up in the sky. And God speaks to the human race. And with the rainbows that he paints, God pledged to Noah, the second father of the human race, that he would never, ever again destroy the entirety of his creation by a flood. And friends, if rainbows stopped appearing in the sky, and that was thousands of years ago, how many know they're still appearing just like they did to Noah? But if they stopped appearing in the sky forever, we never saw another rainbow, we would be tempted to believe that God had somehow changed his mind. But God continually gives us that symbol, that reminder, I will never destroy the entire earth with a flood as I did thousands of years ago. Baptism is in that same category. If we think rainbows are just some kind of an atmospheric optical illusion with no special meaning, no special significance, we deny God's desire to have a covenant relationship with us. I'm so glad that my God chose to bring me into covenant relationship. How many are glad for that this morning? I'm so glad for that. And to neglect, to discount water baptism is just as serious as accusing God of no longer wanting to be in a covenant relationship. We have to also, if we understand the importance, the significance of baptism, we need to understand the proper method of water baptism. Through the example of Jesus Christ and then the continuing pattern that we see over and over again, In the New Testament, Scripture makes it clear that water baptism is to be done by immersion into water and not just the sprinkling of water. Can I hear a good amen? Mark chapter 1 and verse 10 tells us that when Jesus was baptized, and friends, I want to do everything Jesus does. How many are with me this morning? Whatever Jesus does, I want to do. However Jesus does it, I want to do it that way. Because Jesus is my pattern. He's the template. He's my example. I want to do it the way He does it. And it says, Jesus, when He was baptized, He came up out of the water. Now, how many know, physiologically, according to physics, according to common sense, you cannot come up out of water unless you had first gone down underwater. Am I preaching truth this morning? He had to be immersed in order to come up out of the water. John 3:23 tells us that John was baptizing people in a particular location. Anon, it says he was baptizing there because there was much water in that place. If he was not baptizing people by complete immersion in water, if he was only sprinkling, why would the gospel writer make such a point to mention there was much water in that place? There had to be enough water to baptize by immersion. You see, it doesn't take much water to sprinkle, does it? All you need is a little basin of water. Another reason this church here, Edgewood Assembly of God, baptizes by immersion is that the very word that describes this act, this ordinance, this sacrament of the Church of Jesus Christ, the word baptize, it comes from the Greek word baptizo, and that word literally means to dip into and to immerse fully in water. That's pretty clear, isn't it? To dip into or to immerse fully in water. But I still believe that the most important reason that we immerse when we baptize is because of the symbolism of baptism. It's one of the most powerful, one of the most graphic testimonies of salvation that we have. It identifies us with Christ. It is death. It is burial. It is resurrection. It shows we believe in Christ's atoning death, which is our deliverance from the power of sin, and His resurrection 3 days later, which makes it possible for you and I, who apart from the death, burial, and resurrection, we are forever lost in sin. How many realize if Jesus didn't go to Calvary, there's no hope for you and I? There's no hope of heaven. There's no eternal life. It's all because of what Jesus did. It makes it possible for you and I, who were dead in trespasses and sin, and we could do nothing about it, nothing to free ourselves from sin. The one who became dead to the old life of sin, hallelujah, we are now born again and arise to a new life in Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. I'm glad that I was immersed in water. It shows that I am dead to that old life. I go down under the water and symbolically show that my sins, the old way, the old life, the old Steve Schussler, that man is dead, and a new man has risen to resurrection life. New life in Jesus. We also have to understand the formula of baptism. This might be one of the more controversial issues in the church world over the course of time. There's been an awful lot of confusion, a lot of division in church ranks as to the correct formula for water baptism. Some have said, well, I'll take the words of Jesus Christ in the Great Commission. I'll do it the way Jesus said to do it, the words of Jesus. Others said, I'll take the words of Peter and Paul. I'll take the words of the apostles. I see that more frequently in the New Testament. Well, let's look at that this morning. Matthew 28:19, Jesus commands His disciples to go into all the world, to preach the gospel, the good news, to make disciples of all nations, and to baptize new converts in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Is that not what Jesus says? But now in the book of Acts, here's where the confusion comes in. In the book of Acts, we find the apostles, and they are preaching water baptism in four different places, talking about baptism, teaching about it, and they are talking about baptism four different times in the name of Jesus. No mention of the Father, no mention of the Son, just in the name of Jesus. So to the words of Jesus and the words of the apostles, here's the question for us. Do they contradict each other? Well, here's the fact that we have to consider. How many understand this morning we always have to keep the scripture in context? Oh, come on, I need to hear a better amen. You need to keep the Word of God in context. You need to study and look at the context. Don't take a single verse and pull it out and make a doctrine out of it. You've got to keep it in its original context. You've got to look at the verses before and the verses after. You've got to look at the cultural setting. You have to look at the historical setting. You have to look at the circumstance and the situation there. And so they seem to be contradictory. But if you look at the context in which they're spoken, you have to conclude that there is absolutely no contradiction at all. The words of the apostles, when they say to baptize in the name of Jesus, they're not intending here. It's not purposefully trying to lay down a formula for water baptism. They're used here to describe the reason, the purpose of baptism, acknowledging Jesus to be our Christ and Lord, and therefore it's through His authority that we baptize in water, because He's the one who saves us. Amen? He's the one who died. He was buried, raised on the third day. So it's through His authority that we baptize. The apostles were establishing merely the authority for baptism, not the formula. But since Jesus Christ, I think you'll agree with me this morning, Jesus has all authority in heaven and in earth, in all spiritual matters. It's given to Him, delegated to Him by His Father. And Jesus, since He is God the Son, a member of the triune Godhead, same authority as God, He has all authority for all spiritual matters. It's given by the Father, can't be taken away. When Jesus Christ speaks, when He makes a declaration, He never needs to establish authority. Amen? Jesus doesn't need to establish authority for what He says. He is authority. He's authority personified. Not establishing authority. So He is simply and clearly giving His apostles, His disciples, the formula. And since He is our example to follow, we use His directive to baptize in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Would you say amen? There are misunderstandings about baptism that I think need to be clarified. Many churches teach that the act of baptism is what saves you. I talk to people all the time, and I ask them, are you born again? Are you a Christian? Do you know Jesus as your Savior? And they say, yes, I was baptized in 1965. Yes, I'm a Christian. I was baptized into the Christian faith. I'm saved because I'm baptized. A lot of churches teach that. But the Bible that I read clearly teaches that salvation is found alone through repentance and faith in Jesus Christ and the finished work of Calvary. Amen? By grace, through faith, that we're saved. It teaches that we're baptized because we're already saved. We're not baptized in order to become saved. Would you say amen? Let me give you a simple translation of that. An easy way to always remember that. Listen carefully. The power is in the blood. It's not in the tub. Amen? That's an easy way to remember it. The power of salvation, the power to cleanse sin, is in the cleansing power of the only cleansing agent that is strong enough, powerful enough to wash your sins away, and that's the blood of Jesus, not the water that's in that baptismal tank today. Do you understand this morning that if you're a sinner and you get into that tank, you get into that baptistry over there, you will go down a dry sinner and you'll come up a wet sinner. You will. It won't wash your sins away. There is no power in that water to wash a single sin out of your life. It's symbolic. The power is in the blood of Jesus. Amen. You can go to hell with baptism waters all over your face. Yes, you can. You can come up out of that. If you're not born again, you can come up out of that water. And if your life would be taken right then and there, you're not going to heaven. You're only going to heaven if your sins have been forgiven, washed in the blood, and Jesus has saved your life. The thief on the cross, he was saved, but he was never baptized. Did Jesus keep him out of heaven because he wasn't baptized? No, when he pleaded for mercy, said, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus said, today you'll be with me in paradise. He didn't have time to be baptized. He got saved and then he died. There was no time, there was no place to be baptized. But Jesus said, today you'll join me in heaven. You'll be with me in paradise. Hallelujah. You see, Ephesians 2:8 says, by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It's a gift of God, not of any works, lest any man should boast. There's not a single thing you can do to save yourself. You can be baptized 100 times, and that with that act of yourself will not save you. You can give millions of dollars in the offering plate, and that will not save you. You can do wonderful good works for all kinds of people. You can walk little old ladies across the street 1,000 times, and you still won't go to heaven unless your sins have been covered by the blood and Jesus is Lord of your life. You can't do enough good works. It's not of your works that you're saved. It's the precious blood of Jesus. It's that act of grace and your faith in the finished work of Calvary. 1 Peter 3:21, I believe it settles completely the issue by telling us that baptism is not, listen carefully, not the putting away of the filth of the flesh, but it is the answer of a good conscience unto God. Amen. It's saying, I have a good conscience. I stand complete in Him. I stand before God. I no longer have the shame of sin. I no longer have the guilt of sin. I have a clear conscience. I have been washed in the blood of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Washed in the blood. Not saved because I've been washed in a baptistry. Washed in the blood of Jesus. Let's look at the importance of baptism. So many have said to me, well, Pastor, if the thief on the cross who was dying and being crucified next to Jesus, if he got saved, Jesus promised him he would be in heaven and he didn't have a chance to be baptized. If the thief didn't get baptized but he still went to heaven, is water baptism then really that important? Is it really that important? Well, let me illustrate. Let me answer that by saying that after Peter got up on the day of Pentecost and he preached that powerfully convicting sermon and the people cried out, so what do we need to do now? This is what Peter said. Without any hesitation, without any quivering in his voice, Peter said, repent and be baptized. Did he not? Repent of your sins. And then be baptized. Cornelius the soldier told Peter, okay, Peter, we've gathered all here together to hear you tell us all the things that God commands us to do. We want to know how to please God. We want to know how to live for God every day. We want to know what pleases God, what displeases Him. We want to know how to live. And Peter responded by commanding them right then and there to be baptized. Yes, water baptism is very, very important. You see, from the day of Pentecost, when the church was first established, first formed, in Acts chapter 2, and if you follow the church all the way to the end of the book of Acts, Acts 28, whenever conversions are mentioned, without a single exception at all, they're connected with and followed by water baptism. Always. So to neglect this very plain, very clear, very strong command of the Lord is a serious act, friends, of disobedience to God. It's that serious. You know, in some countries today, in fact, in a number of countries today, a person risks his life by obeying that command to be baptized. In fact, in most cultures around the world, that is the defining mark of a born-again Christian. That's the defining mark of someone who has embraced faith in Jesus Christ and is identifying with the Christian faith. They don't think a whole lot about them. They're not worried a whole lot until they see Christians go public with their faith and are baptized in water. In fact, there's many nations today. My brother was a missionary for a number of years to the nation of China. In the nation of China, when you become a Christian, they have their water baptism ceremonies way out in the country. They don't do it in the city. They go out in the country because, you see, if the government and the police find out that there is a baptismal service, they will come, they'll stop it, they will arrest everyone there, and they will be put in jail because they're being baptized in water. They have to do it out in the middle of nowhere. So it's not to have the government stop the proceedings there. In many countries, people risk their lives. They risk the lives of their families to follow the Lord in water baptism. You know that in some cultures, they hold funerals. Funerals for family members who dare to have the audacity to identify with the Christian faith through water baptism. They tell their family members, the minute you're baptized in water, we're going to have a funeral service for you because you are dead to us for the rest of your life. You're not welcome in our home. You're not welcome at family gatherings. You're not a part of this family anymore. They lose their identity with their family, lose all contact with their family when they're baptized in water, and yet they do it anyway because Jesus and obeying His command is that important to them. Jesus is their all in all. They're willing to give up life. They're willing to give up family, give up everything, their jobs. Many cultures, when people are baptized in water, they immediately lose their employment. They're no longer employed. They lose benefits. Some of them lose their homes. They lose everything by identifying with Jesus in water baptism. But here in America, there's very little resistance, very little stigma that is attached, no consequences really for most Americans to be baptized in water. But you know something consequent to that? Because most of us will not ever be arrested for being baptized in water, or maybe even be arrested for being a Christian in our lifetime, a lot of American Christians think it must not be that important, must not be that necessary. I want you to know this morning, friends, listen to me carefully. I know this is more teaching than preaching, but these are things we have to know today. I want you to listen to me. We do not obey our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ because it's easy or because it's hard. We don't obey the Lord Jesus Christ either because it's popular or whether it's unpopular. We don't obey the Lord Jesus Christ because it is convenient or inconvenient. We obey the Lord Jesus Christ today simply because we have said to Him, "You are Lord. You're Lord. You're Lord of my life. Your every wish is my command. Whatever you command me to do, Lord, your servant hears and your servant obeys." We do it because He is Lord. And someday, friends, every knee will bow, every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, that He was right all along. He's all that He ever declared He was. We obey Him. He is Lord. He is King today. Lord of our lives, King of our lives today. He is Lord. Friends, soon and very soon, I believe we're going to stand before our Lord. I believe every one of us soon and very soon are going to stand before our Lord. We're going to stand before all the hosts of heaven. And we're also going to stand in eternity in heaven someday with tens of thousands of people who have had the honor and had the privilege, and that's how they look at it, they have had the honor and privilege of dying a physical death for their faith in Jesus Christ. Died martyrs because they followed Jesus and they obeyed Him in water baptism. We're going to be standing in heaven next to people who have been beheaded. We've seen beheadings just recently in the news, haven't we? One of the most wicked, evil, hateful things to see an innocent person with their hands tied and held there. Someone puts a knife and slits their neck and takes their head off. There's going to be martyrs in heaven that will be there because they were beheaded for their faith and their stand for Jesus. They could have refuted Christ. They could have said, no, I don't belong to Him. They could have pulled a Peter and said, no, I'm sorry. You got the wrong person. That's not me. I'm not one of His. I'm not one of them. And they could have saved their lives, but they said, yes. Yes, I'm a Christian. Yes, I serve Jesus. Yes, You can take my life, but I'm not denying my Savior and my Lord. We're going to stand in heaven next to people who were boiled in acid and boiled in hot oil, boiled alive because they were baptized and declared publicly that they were followers of Jesus Christ. Folks, I'm not playing games this morning. This is serious business. We're going to stand by people in heaven who were subjected to a firing squad. They had a blindfold on and said, are you sure you don't want to recant your belief in Jesus Christ? And they said, no, no, I don't care if the bullets of every single one of those machine guns goes right through my head. I will not deny my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And I want to ask you, friends, this morning, every one of us need to consider this today. In the presence of all of those martyrs, in the presence of the one who died the most torturous death in all of history, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, will any one of us here dare to say to Him who gave His life, dare to say in the company of martyrs that gave everything and lost everything to win Jesus Christ, Lord, I hope You understand, but you see, I have a fear of water and I just couldn't bring myself to be baptized. Will we dare to say in the presence of Jesus Christ, Lord, You know how particular I am about my personal appearance. I don't want to get soaking wet in front of people that I know. I don't want my makeup and my mascara to run down my face in public, in front of all of those people. Will any of us dare to make statements like that? I say to you this morning, if that's the holdup, if that's the problem you have with being baptized in water, you don't want to appear soaking wet in front of people that you know for the sake of Jesus. You don't want smeared makeup on your face for the sake of Jesus Christ. I want to tell you this morning, I got news for you, friends. You're already too late. You've been wet all over for a long time. Amen? Amen? Jesus said in Mark 8:38, if you're ashamed of me now, I'll be ashamed of you in the presence of my Father. That's pretty strong language, friends. Jesus said, I'll be ashamed of you in front of my Father. Man, I don't want to stand up there and have Jesus look at me and hang His head and turn His eyes away from me saying, I'm sorry, I'm ashamed of you. You wouldn't take a public stand for me. You were worried more about how you were appearing. You were worried more about temporal things than you were being identified with me and eternal life. You see, no Christian can, with any kind of a good conscience, justify non-compliance with this command of the Lord Jesus Christ to be baptized in water. Final question. So who can and who should be baptized in water? My Bible teaches that believers and believers only should be baptized. In every instance in Scripture, you can look up every instance. It holds true today as well. The test is individual faith. Individual faith. Since many churches baptize infants and babies, Where should we stand on that particular practice? Let me tell you, children, until they come to the age of accountability, until they can understand that they are sinners in need of a Savior and understand what it means to be saved, they're not expected to exercise saving faith. An infant can't repent of its sins or convert to Jesus Christ or believe in Jesus. They're not mentally developed enough yet to know that Jesus is their Savior and Lord. Furthermore, the Bible, which has to be always, and I want to hear a good amen here, always has to be our rule for faith and practice, never commands infant baptism and gives not a single example of infant baptism. That's why we have parents present their children in dedication to the Lord, not in water baptism. So when should a Christian be baptized? That answer is very simple. ASAP. As soon as possible. Soon as possible. In Acts 8:36, the Ethiopian eunuch, he was baptized as soon as he believed. He was reading the book of Isaiah, didn't understand it. God transported Philip right next to him on that lonely road, climbed up in the chariot, explained to him the plan of salvation. As soon as he understood it, he said, "I believe." And he said, "There's water right over there. Is there any reason I can't be baptized right now? I just believed. Can I be baptized?" Philip said, "No problem." They got out of the chariot, walked over there, and he baptized him. My Bible says the Apostle Paul was baptized hours after his conversion on the road to Damascus. Lydia and her whole household were baptized soon after their conversion. Oh, friends, this morning, this experience of water baptism, it's powerful. It's wonderful. It is necessary. It's a command of God. It's an important part of your journey of faith and your walk with the Lord. You see, it's a great reminder that we are joint heirs with Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. And that we have identified with His death, with His burial, with His resurrection. And we have also identified with His victory. Hallelujah. Glory to God. We have everlasting life. My baptism tells me that. When I look back and I remember my baptism, it tells me I share in the victory of Jesus Christ over sin, self, and Satan. Hallelujah. Baptism tells me that my affection should not be set on the things of this world, things below, things that are passing away. This old world is decaying. It's going to pass away. My affections are set on things that are above. Hallelujah. Not on things of this old sinful world. It tells me to love His appearing. That's what my baptism tells me. Look for His appearing. He's coming. He's coming soon in clouds of glory. And the ultimate fulfillment of our salvation is right on the horizon. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. We're going to stand with Him and worship Him for all of eternity. Hallelujah. My baptism, your baptism, it tells you that just like Abraham, you ought to be looking for a city whose maker and builder is God. Don't look for things down here. Start looking upward. Get your eyes on the eastern sky. He's coming. He's coming. He's coming. Hallelujah. Look for that city whose builder and maker is God. My baptism reminds me I can think now with a resurrected mind. I have the mind of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. I don't have to think like people in this world. I don't have to think about the affections of things below. I can think on things that are pure, that are holy, that are lovely, that are of good report. That's what my baptism tells me. I have been transformed. My mind has been transformed. I've been renewed. I have a brand new mind, a brand new thought life, a brand new thought process today. Oh, friends, let me tell you, I'm going to get serious. You suffer in your Christian walk when you continually refuse and you neglect water baptism. You suffer. You are sinning. You are disobeying God, a direct command. It is part and parcel with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Water baptism is not an option. Can I hear an amen?
Amen.
It is a mandatory command. It's a must. I ask you this morning as I close, have you obeyed this important command of the Lord Jesus Christ? And I want to further ask you, have you fulfilled the prerequisites of giving your heart and life to Christ in order to be baptized? My Bible says, today is the day of salvation. Now is the accepted time. You've not given your life to Jesus. Do it today. Do it today. Identify with Jesus. Come into one with Him today. Say, Jesus, my life isn't working with me in charge. I don't want you to be the co-pilot. Lord, I want you to be the pilot of my life. Today is the day. Now is the accepted time. Praise God, to let Jesus Christ make an eternal, forever internal change in your life. And then you can go public with it and be baptized in water. I want every head bowed, every eye closed this morning. Praise God. Every head bowed, every eye closed. I wonder this morning if there's somebody here today in this sanctuary. You don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. You're here and you are living for yourself. You're doing your own thing. You have never come under the Lordship of Jesus Christ. You've never said, Jesus, I give all of me to you. I want all of you to fill all of me. I want you to come in. I want you to take over. You see, Jesus, when He comes to us, He demands that He take over. He doesn't want just a part of us. A part of us is not enough. He needs all of us. He requires all of us. I wonder, is there somebody here this morning? As the worship team begins to just softly play right now, you say, Pastor, I want to know that I'm right with God. I want to be sure of my eternal salvation. Today, before I walk out of this building, because I don't know what's going to happen to me the rest of this day. Friends, every day, people leave their homes. They leave their place of employment. They get in their car. And they never make it to the next destination. They never make it. They're ushered into eternity. Sometimes before they get a mile down the road. It's that serious. That's why the Bible says now is the accepted time. Today. Today's the day of salvation. Tomorrow might be forever too late. Are you here today? You're not living for God. Not letting Him be in charge of everything. You haven't confessed all your sins. You're not living to please Him. Living to obey His every command. You say, Pastor, I want to make things right with Him. I want to make sure He's Lord. Not just my Savior, but I want to make sure He's Lord of my life. He's in complete control. He's in full charge of my life. Can I see your hand right now? No one's looking around. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Only God and I are looking right now. Would you raise your hand? Would you raise your hand and say, Pastor, that's me. I want to make sure. Don't want to leave this place. Don't want to walk out of this building without knowing that I'm prepared for eternity. I'm ready to meet Jesus. I'm absolutely 100% sure that I'm ready to meet the Lord. If you're not absolutely sure, I want to see your hand right now. If you're not absolutely sure that everything is right with God, I want to see your hand. We want to pray with you this morning. Praise God. Is there anyone here this morning? That's you today. You want to make things right with Jesus. Anyone this morning? I'll wait just a moment. And we're going to move into our time of water baptism this morning. But, oh, this is the time to come to Jesus. When Jesus is beckoning. When He's speaking to our heart. When the Holy Spirit is making us feel uncomfortable. He's convicting. He's gnawing at us. We can only come to Jesus when the Holy Spirit draws. Now is the time. It's time to come. If the Holy Spirit's drawing you, He's reaching out to you. He's tugging on your heart. He's knocking, saying, please, let me in. Would you let me into your life? I'll make more of your life than you could ever make of it on your own. I've got great plans for you, but I can't reveal them. They can't be unfolded in your life until you give me everything. You give me everything. Is there anyone that'll say, Pastor, I want to give Jesus everything this morning. I want to give Him everything. Praise God. I'm trusting this morning that everyone has made things right with God, but this altar will remain open. If at any time, even during our baptismal service, the Holy Spirit's dealing with you, you need to come. Maybe there's just some things in your life, and maybe you've just been rebelling against some things that Jesus is calling you to do, asking you to do. You're just not walking close to the Lord. Maybe there's just a besetting sin in your life. Just one thing that you can't get victory over, and you just want to be free of that particular bondage in your life. Man, just come and kneel at this altar. Someone will come right beside you, and they'll pray with you. And they'll pray with you this morning to receive Christ, to rededicate, to pray through on that problem, that situation, that strained relationship, or that financial need, whatever you might have need of this morning, this altar will remain open. But at this time, I want to encourage family members of those that are being baptized, friends, close friends, family members, you can come right over here. We have these first four rows there just set aside for you right in front of the baptistry. Feel free to come down there, and I'm going to come off the platform. And I have a charge for our baptismal candidates this morning. Like I said, we have some wonderful folks today, some beautiful testimonies that we're going to hear in just a moment. But I'm going to give them a charge, and then we're going to make final preparation. Pastor Tracy and I are candidates to get into the baptistry, but I'm going to turn things back over to our worship team at this time as they continue to lead us in worship. I want you to worship with them. Praise God. And then I want you to rejoice in a few moments with those that are being baptized. It doesn't even matter if you know them or not. Man, this is a wonderful way for them to publicly declare their faith and for us to be eyewitnesses, amen? Witnesses to public confessions of faith this morning. This is an important part for all of us in the body of Christ. Praise God. We rejoice with those that rejoice, amen? Just like we weep with those that weep, we rejoice with those that rejoice. Praise God. I'm going to ask that the music be soft at first as I'm giving a charge to those that are being baptized, and then we're going to go into full worship mode for a few moments, and we'll be preparing at this time for water baptism. Praise God. We will have, in fact, after the baptism is concluded, if you're a first-time guest, or you're here maybe for the second time or the first time in a while, and you have never had our first-time guest reception, we have some nice light refreshments over in the other building. You go into across the way to the other building and into the main lobby, make a right into the old sanctuary. We're going to have some refreshments ready. I'll get over there as quickly and as soon as I can after baptism, but we will have a reception for all of our guests, and we invite you to stay.